I'm always fascinated by the German idea of the Waldgeist, the spirit in the wood. The natural spirit within the landscape reaches out towards the artist and invites him to come to terms with its forms and its shapes and create an image that echoes that response. The landscape is also a repository of memory. One will think of one's childhood, usually with some sort of landscape notation. The landscape is signaling to me what a known place is. And my sense of place throughout my life has always been paced upon the images from the landscape that occur to me naturally when I'm beginning to draw towards the landscape. John Hewitt, the Lens of Antrim poet, perhaps rather arrogantly, said, "I have turned to the landscape because men disappoint me." Well, I turn to the landscape, but I'm not sure whether men disappoint me or not, but I've turned to it because I feel I hear the voices of men in it. Whether it's in a ruin, or a tree that has been felled, or perhaps trees that have been planted deliberately by men to make a classical pattern, and their voices are in that landscape still. And then I have the problem of interpreting that through paint. There's also a more subtle thing in the landscape, particularly in Fermanagh. I see the gradual evolution of human forms lost again in the landscape, so that one naturally talks about flanks or about a shoulder of rock. And sometimes when I look along a lovely, soft run of hills, I see a landscape with the seductive declivities of a woman and her soft curves. No matter what you are, we're all, I think, programmed by our childhood, and we all see things with what we retain of that innocent eye. Some people retain more of the innocent eye than others do, and artists, I suppose, retain the most of it. Even though in my time I've painted boglands and mountain landscapes, I still feel that at the very core of my ambitions as a landscape painter lies my essential landscape with its vocabulary of dense trees and reflective water and reeds and rushes. An aquatic landscape. When I was a teenager, one of my favourite readings was Wordsworth's The Prelude. And I remember out of that great poem that really charts, if you like, not so much the physical development of a man, but of his aesthetic imagination in contact with nature. fair seed time had my soul, and I grew up fostered alike by beauty and by fear. I dread the rustling of the grass. The very shadows of the clouds have power to shake me as they pass. And something that made a strong impression on me from this prelude of Wordsworth was the idea of him saying that fair seed time had my soul. In other words, that in an environment, his own personality and his aesthetic imagination was growing like a seed and being nourished by this increasing awareness of a sense of place and his position within it. I think that by being born into a place, in my case into Fermanagh, it is inevitable as a landscape painter that I have gone in a certain way, and that way has been signposted by the forms and colours and light that are peculiar and indigenous to County Fermanagh. Of course, I wouldn't want to infer that I have a sort of personal monopoly of place or what should be the place that inspires the artist. For instance, in the wilder, more denuded parts of the west of Ireland, Paul Henry found a place for his thought and for the images he wanted to make out of something much more arid. The glint of sunlight on hard rock and the occasional sentinel-like tree. Equally, Gerard Dillon, when he went to the west of Ireland, he had what one might call a Celtic instinct for an older place than Paul Henry saw through his eyes. When Dillon looked at the Irish landscape, and particularly at the landscape of the west of Ireland, he felt a kinship with something that isn't immediately evident, and that is a type of almost Bronze Age atmosphere in it. And he was impelled to translate it into a sort of frontality, something rather like the carvings on an ancient Celtic cross. Through my own watercolours, I became interested in Andrew Nicol, the 19th century Belfast artist, whose Antrim Coast paintings, I think, have a formality and a clarity I find most attractive. Seeing and perceiving, the act of sight and the act of perception, are two different things. When artists perceive something, they are also perceiving it in terms of resolving it. And the moment you begin that process, strangely, into your mind comes, this is definitely a landscape for oil, or this is definitely a landscape for watercolour. Because the sort of plastic language of a particular material has its own quality, and that answers to your imaginative call at a particular time. Nobody uses the palette that they squeeze out. You begin to mix almost from the start to make the tint of a colour that you're going to use. All colour changes, like a girl blushing at a compliment. Tone is really the little journey that the colour takes between darkness and brightness. Tint is the change of complexion that occurs while that journey's in process. I suppose I use the same palette, really, for both watercolour painting and oil or acrylic painting. Being an Irish painter, one has a sort of affection for green and grey. Then one has got the old earth colours that are in the landscape, the umbers and the ochres and the golden siennas. And in between there somewhere also a nice yellow, a cadmium perhaps, that is lifted right out of the whinbush, has the same intensity of colour. I'm here at Powerscourt Waterfall in the full summer. As always when I come here, I feel that I've also come into the past. In the 18th century, along with the Giant's Causeway and the Eagle's Rock in Killarney, it was rather like a place people came to see as a natural wonder, the way one would go to the pyramids in Egypt. To me, it's essentially an 18th century place. When, in that century, the agriculturist and compulsive traveller Arthur Young came here, he recorded in his journal the sense of mystery and power and almost awe that the oak groves inspired in him. He talked about terrible shadows and awful sounds. But of course, what he was doing really was he was reacting to this idea of the picturesque, which had preoccupied a great deal of aesthetic appreciation of landscape in the 18th century. He was seeking for the sublime, that much more powerful and awesome alternative to mere beauty, monumental natural beauty being infused with a sense of terror and apprehension. I don't think that anybody caught this better than George Barrett in his great painting of the Powerscourt Waterfall, where the sense of a torrent, something almost animal-like being unleashed from the cleft of the hill, is both awe-inspiring, terrifying, and extremely beautiful. I'm also reminded in a sort of whimsical way that far away across the other side of the world, the Japanese artists were, shall we say, worshipping waterfalls. But their approach, as for instance in Hokusai's approach to a waterfall, was to a degree to abstract it. Hokusai saw the waterfall much more in a passive sense. It was a sort of sonorous screen of water. I, last autumn, came back to confront, in my case, Powers Court as a subject for my own painting. And I decided to pitch my tent between those two polarities, the Japanese of Hokusai and the romantic 18th century temperament of Barrett. I realized as I stood in front of the waterfall that I couldn't find the viewpoint that would totally sum up the experience. And for that reason, I, as it were, stalked it for a while, reconnoitred round it. I decided to make it not a single running picture, if you like, but a sequence of three individual aspects of the picture, a triptych. When you stand in front of it, you're impelled to look up it. But as you do that, you're very, very aware of what is on your left and what is on your right. And you feel that these things that are in a way at the corner of your eye, if you took them away, you are not getting the totality of the experience of the waterfall. I must say that the roots and sources of my quality landscape picture are certainly centred in 18th century landscape painting, and particularly in Irish 18th century landscape painting, because there's a quality of classical balance and classical restraint, and certainly a refusal to be seduced to too much a degree with what the fields and the trees are offering you as a painter, and rather to discipline them into your more abstract vision. Arthur O'Connor was the major Irish landscape painter at the end of the 18th century and for a while into the 19th century. And the popularity of his paintings is very well summarized in this painting. Compositionally, this painting is very classical in that it's very ordered. The trees, for instance, are not alone trees. They also form the type of function that a column would form sustaining a classical building. Landscape painting is nature seen through a temperament, and this is a very 18th century temperament. This picture is called The Poachers, and naturally they're out in the moonlight, so the picture is illuminated by moonlight, which always in nature as well as in art has that cool, calming tonality, and this floods throughout the whole painting, sustaining it and unifying it, and also I think conferring on these sort of 19th century rascals a type of dignity, so that they are people not looking for rabbits or hares or whatever they're out looking for, but people amazed by this great and beautiful natural phenomena. At times, O'Connor was accused of sentimentality and of not, in a modern term, reporting the truth. This is an Irish lane with a farmer going home to what, by the look of him, is yet another good supper. He's very attractively dressed with his smart red waistcoat, which just very fortunately complements the blue and green of the distance. Now, contemporary with this painting, of course, the railroads of Ireland would have been thronged with the poor and the hungry, the dispossessed. But O'Connor was not painting actual nature or the actual happenings in nature. And that doesn't worry me. As an artist, I take a painting on its own terms, and I take a landscape painting on its own terms. It's a painted landscape, not a natural landscape. And to me, anything is justifiable within it if it chimes in with the temperament and purpose of the painter. I think it was in the mid-1970s, Lord Belmer invited me to come to Castle Cool and paint a picture of the house. I had painted, if you like, big houses before, most notably for myself, the painting of Lissadale House in County Sligo, a Regency mansion, much smaller than this Palladian palace here. Here was something complex. Here was a great work of art set in the green meadows of Fermanagh and craving for what it got, a setting that would naturally chime in with the proportion and individual detail of a beautiful house. I realized very quickly that one oil painting wasn't going to do the complete job. So I started to move round the house, picking vantage points from the lawn or among trees from which I could look back and see, if you like, different faces of the place. I was impelled to use watercolour because I was very aware that in the 18th century, when the house would have been built, that watercolour as a medium for topographical recording was the popular medium. What I wanted to do was follow that tradition, not merely with a descriptive wash over a pencil drawing, but with a sort of conspiracy of wash and drawing that would bring out the personality of the house and the mood and romantic atmosphere of its surroundings. Something grew out of this whole commission that had quite an effect on my own approach to landscape painting, in that it made me rethink about what landscape painting could be about, and in this instance, how all the marvellous achievements by Irish landscape painters in the 18th century were in a way behind me in this. I was feeling that I had some sort of metaphysical support hidden in here behind the trees. And in my mind's eye, I was thinking of painters like Thomas Roberts, who painted quite a number of formal landscapes in which large houses played a very important role. I'm at the second stage of a painting I've planned to do. The subject of the painting is Glendun, and the idea is to paint early spring when the winds are just starting to come out. I'm starting now to draw freely using my sketch as reference and to develop the surface quality of the painting I intend to make. I'll probably end up making the painting in acrylic or in oil, but the technique is the same. I'm using charcoal, a charcoal pencil, on a fairly grainy paper, because as the charcoal breaks or smudges or makes a hard line, it's the nearest I can think of to the type of response with a surface that I'll get when I'm working with pigment on the finished canvas. feel that hill and the rocks that are coming out of it. I want to feel it coming down, because obviously up here where the cloud is passing over the hill, there's going to be a dark brow on the hill in that place. Then you've got all these little intrusions of the rock coming down. Things becomes more dramatic. I want to find in this landscape its own structures and shape them and change them to suit the design that I'm making here on the surface. The painting is also an emotional one for me, because I've decided when it's finished to dedicate it to the poet John Hewitt and his wife Ruby. So the painting will be called Glen Dun for John and Ruby Hewitt. I need this sort of emotional engagement with any landscape that I do, really, because it disengages for me any instinct to give in and just make a picture. When I was a child growing up in Fermanagh, there was an old man who was a water diviner, and he used to walk about with a hazel wand, and when he found water, the rod in his hand bent and turned, and whatever the response from the water beneath the ground was having, it seemed to be running down his arm into the stick. And the act of painting is rather like that, that you get an excitement in your head and in your eye, and when you dip your brush into pigment and start expressing yourself, it's like divining for water. You're finding hidden springs, not in the landscape necessarily, but in your own head, imaginings. And you're automatically, and you really don't know how you're doing this, automatically the paint sort of helps you out and begins to make its own thickness or its own thinness. It begins to make a texture that is equivalent in a painterly way to the natural surface that you're looking at. When I'm working with oil or acrylic, I'm aware that I'm working in a non-transparent medium, which has its own characteristics. And these are the texture, weight, and density of the paint, and the enjoyment of putting on a brush mark, which will have its own characteristic as it's dragged over the texture of the canvas. Through my friendship with John Hewitt, I was fortunate in meeting a number of artists, and probably the one I was impressed by most and remember most was John Luke. He painted like an Italian master, and he used the methods of that type of painting. This painting of Luke's called The Rehearsal is probably one of the most intriguing pictures to come from his brush, because I think within it are contained all the elements of his unique and peculiar style. The picture itself is a blend of Luke's landscape approach and his obsession with the figurative, and particularly with the decoratively figurative. The figures themselves individually, with their drapery and their colours, set up patterns that are echoed in the formalised landscape behind. But the thing that's most interesting in this painting as a landscape is the way the sky is treated. There are a lot of ribbons, there are a lot of pleating, a lot of circles and so on in the figures themselves. And the sky is like an unravelling, a brilliant unfurling so that it flows out in this great sort of celebration of design. Obviously, this is a mythical landscape, but clearly, while those mountains look rather as if they'd come out of some island in the Philippines or somewhere, they're tall and conical, the mindset creating them must have been centred in the Mourne's and Luke's memory and associations with the Mourne Mountains and with County Down. Luke's method, working from detailed drawings and then putting the whole picture down in a type of monochrome, which associated him with the painting style he most admired, the Italian 14th and 15th century style, and then building on that with coloured glazes and layers of detail, produced a final image that was not alone a celebration of its origins in the Irish landscape, but also a recording of his almost veneration for the European-Italian style which inspired him. This painting of mine was painted as a tribute to a friend who was murdered by terrorists. It is based on a Poussin called Echo and Narcissus. The Poussin figure is a dead man lying on the ground. But I wanted to translate this original figure into something more like an icon, something that was an emblem of grief and of nostalgia and remembrance and tribute on my part. I had to dehumanize the figure, first of all, by taking away all the natural flesh tints that Poussin had painted so endearingly in his version. And mine becomes very much a dead man, or if you like, a marble man, who is draped with a garment that becomes gradually in its folds and meanderings the equivalent of running water or of a mountain range. What I get from the Poussin itself is a feeling of some figure which has been gradually taken into the earth, as it were, has become part of the earth. I removed the classical trappings and ended up with a figure which, in my opinion, or I was trying to get it to look just as much a landscape as a prone figure. When I saw the television report of the murder of this lawyer and I saw his body come out on a stretcher covered with a sheet, one of his feet was sticking out from under the sheet. And for no reason whatever, the Poussin painting came into my mind. There's something at the same time aloof and alluring about a cliff face. When that cliff face becomes blasted and cut into by man and it becomes a quarry face, there are obviously a number of cross associations, the original natural primitive forms, and then the type of accidental sculpture achieved on the cliff face by the blasting in of a quarry. Here at Carrickrae, it was that tension that fascinated me because the forms are both natural and man-made. And the colours, I don't know whether they are essentially natural or whether they owe something to the violence of the dynamite, but I find that lovely blend of raw sienna and yellow ochre and the pale natural silver of rock very fascinating and certainly very engaging. When the artist is liberated and freed from the necessity of a somewhat precise rendition, the paint becomes a personality in the picture. This opens the way to the possibility of taking risks, because when you are released and no longer feel a public obligation to be topographical, you can allow the paint to direct you towards your subject. The paint, just as much as you, will take risks when you're sweeping across a field of corn or you're coming down the edge of a hill. It's the paint that is coming with you. Your eye is become a painter's eye with the pigment, its vocal expression. Light is the other eye. Light is what is caressing things that you're painting. It's what's contrasting them, heightening them, blurring them out. The presence of light, the absence of light, triggers off and presents the painter with the problem of what we call tone. How dark a colour should be or how light it should be as it describes this birth or decrease of light. Any artist whom I have admired them because I can see that they are presenting an individual and refreshing alternative to the commonly accepted picture of a field or of a hill or a mountain or whatever. I do consider myself a landscape painter. But I would make one simple and definite point. I would hope that when I paint a landscape, I'm not just reproducing what most people have seen and accepted. I am trying to open another window to see the landscape through the particular filter of my own individual inspiration.